I think she could have kept going there. I am so glad that you're here. We want to welcome all of you. Welcome to those of you that are watching online and in our different venues. We are glad you're here. A couple weeks ago, we asked the question, when Jesus was asked, what's the most important thing? What's the one thing that you need to do? Jesus responded, most important thing in your life is that you love God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and love your neighbor. The surprise is he had two answers, love God and just equal to it, to love your neighbor. And we realize that the world is not the way that it should be. People are alienated from God, from each other, even from themselves. And that loneliness that comes a part of that God's strategy is for us to be a part of what he's doing in the world. And so we thought, you know, maybe Jesus was really a genius when he said this. Maybe he got it right. And that the idea of loving God was the greatest thing that we needed to do for ourselves. But loving our neighbor really was Jesus' strategy to change this world, where we would bring love and kindness and goodness, Jesus' love, into our neighborhood and begin the change there and go to the whole world. And so we ask the question, is it possible to love your neighbor if you don't know their names? No. And so we said, well, we got to know the names and one thing about them. And so we've committed together, right, to know our neighbors' names and one thing about them so we can be praying for God's good to come into their life and God's good to come into our neighborhood. So during this holiday season, we're all committed to finding out our neighbors' names and praying for God's good to come into their life, right? Yes. Okay, that wasn't enough. So you're into it. So you're committed to this, right? All right, so we are going to learn their names during this holiday season, right? Yes. All right, so you're in a church, and if you don't do it, then you just lied, and bad things will happen if you don't do that. So we're moving in that. If you would, pull out your outlines. We're going to look at God's Word together. This is, I think, one of the best weekends that you can be in church. In fact, I think of all... You know, there's lots of important weekends, but this is one of the most important weekends to be in church. So you are in the right place because this is the last sane moment of your life. Do you know what happens? You get to Wednesday, you get to experience Thanksgiving, and then Thursday's Thanksgiving, we come, and then on Friday, it's called Black Friday, right? And they're even starting it earlier and earlier. But all of a sudden, the whole world is revving up and it's going to explode into motion. And over the next 30, 35 days, you are going to eat more, buy more, consume more than in the whole other 11 months combined. You're going to decorate your house inside and out. You're going to buy a tree and decorate it. You're going to go to more office parties, more family celebrations, buy more gifts, receive more gifts. dying. Okay, I started it back up. And you're going to do more than in all the other times combined. And, you know, it's just overwhelming, and you get charging into it, and it can overwhelm you. And then besides that, you have the year end that's going too. And so it is absolutely this time where the world is revving up, and you're just going to explode into motion. Reminds me of when I was a kid at 16, we all got our license. And when we got our license, the upperclassmen had it was the tradition in my high school that they would teach you how to do power braking and do a neutral drop. It was just part of something they passed on to underclassmen. And so you would go out, and I grew up in the cars. It was during the muscle car era. And so the family car was a station wagon with like a 427 with a big four barrel on it. It's monster horsepower. And these cars had like these bias ply tires. They didn't have like radials on them. And so you'd go out, and you just got your license, and your friend would be with you in the car, and he'd teach you how to power brake. And essentially what you do is you get on an open road, and you would put your foot on the brake and then just push on the gas, and the car would just bolt up and hunch forward and just going like that. And then you'd let off the brake, and the tires would just smoke, and you'd see how long you could lay this big patch of rubber on the street and still keep the car without, you know, swerving off. And it would be just emotionally exciting. And, you know, for a guy, it's just like hormones. And you're going, yeah, and you didn't crash. And then after you figured out how to do that, you learned how to do a neutral drop. And a neutral drop is where you put the car in neutral, and so you would rev the engine, just punch it down to the floor, and when it just got going full blast, just screaming, you would take it and just slam it into low. And so the car would just, and it just tires smoking and burning, and you would just go down the road, and it was awesome. And you'd do that, and you'd burn a whole set of tires off the car, and you'd bring the car back, and it literally would just come into the driveway, laying on its tires, tongue hanging out, smoking, just begging, you know, and it was so cool. And that is kind of what is going to happen to you over the next 35 days. Marketeers are just revving their engines, going full blast. You'll have Thanksgiving Day. It'll be peace and quiet. And then wham, and off you go. And you will just go as fast as you can. And at the end of the 35 days, you're going to end up, you know, pulling into your house, laying on your tires, smoking, credit cards burn up, emotions dying. And you're going, what happened? And so what I want to do is I want to help you avoid that and go through the next season, these next 35 days, where you protect your heart from that kind of experience. Understand this, Christmas is not a biblically prescribed holiday. The Bible never talks about celebrating Jesus' birth, especially the way we do it. Thanksgiving is actually a biblically prescribed holiday. In the Old Testament, the people of God took 1 week long to celebrate just the concept of Thanksgiving. Not exactly the way we do it, but the idea of being thankful for all that God's done. And I think that the reason, this is the last sane moment, that if you can get kind of your spiritual bearings and you can commit over the next 35 days to every day begin by making a list of the 10 things that you're grateful for, I believe it can change your life. You will get, at the end of this season, your soul will not be burned up and you won't be smoking and overwhelmed with all the emotion, but you can say, I did this right. And that's my goal. And I've given this same message for the last 28 years. I skipped it one time and y'all got mad. So we come back every time and this is the same message. And so people around you, they might be saying the answers to things or screaming out stuff and you're going, how'd you know that? And it's because we've done this for 27 years. So if you pull out your outline, we'll go through, we're going to talk about what does it mean to be grateful. What's the one thing that no one has in Orange County? Enough. I mean, we live in the land of not enoughness. I mean, there's always more, and we live with this idea, if I just get this one more thing, then I will be grateful. And I want to show you today what happens when you live with that if-then mentality. You know, you say, if I can just get my degree in college, then I'll be grateful. If I can just get a spouse, then I'll be grateful. If I can just get that first job, then if I can get the first house, then I'll be grateful. If we can just have kids, then I'll be grateful. If I can just get those kids out of the house, then I'll be grateful. You know, if I can just get my life together, then I'll be grateful. But there is this mindset that I can't be grateful where I am, but if these things happen, then I'll be grateful. And what I want you to see is where that mindset leads to. The Bible's very clear. And so the most definitive story in the Old Testament, the defining story of the Old Testament, is the story of the Exodus. And so we're going to look at that. If you've got a Bible, turn in your Bibles to Exodus 15. You know the story, if you've read the Bible, if you've seen the movie with Charlton Heston, the book is better, that what you have is the people of God find themselves enslaved to Egypt for 400 years. And they cry out to God and they say, God, if you would deliver us from slavery, we would be grateful. We would be free and we would be grateful. It's the only thing that we'd ever want. Parents, you've all experienced this kind of a moment. Your kid comes up to you, it's in a toy store, they bring you this one toy, and they look at you with those big eyes, and they say, if you bought me this toy, I would never want anything else in my whole life. I will be eternally grateful. I will do all of my chores. I will rise up every day and call you blessed. If you just give me this one toy, I'll never want anything else. I'll be grateful. Only a child would be so foolish to say that. Only a child, right? The problem is that we all say that, and so we're going to look at God's people and see what happens, because the people cry out and they say, God, if you just would deliver us. And so God sends Moses and delivers the people of God with 10 plagues, his mighty right arm, and not only does he deliver them out of slavery, But as they come out of the slavery of Egypt, they see God's power. God causes the Egyptians to want to bless these people that have been enslaved for 400 years, and so they give them all of this wealth. They literally come out wealthy people out of slavery. They said, God, if you do that, we would be grateful. And so they come out, takes them through the Red Sea. 3 days later, just 3 days after this defining thing where God says, if you do this, we will forever be grateful. Exodus 15, 22, it says, then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went to the desert of Sur. For 3 days, they traveled in the desert without finding water. And then they came to Marah. They could not drink its water because it was bitter. And that's why it's called Marah. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, what are we to drink? And the story goes on, and they said, God, you brought us here to die. You didn't give to us, and now we're going to die. You got to give us thirst. And it only took them 3 days before they said, God, if you don't give us water, then we can't be grateful. 3 days. And so God gives them water. Gives them water here, and then gives them water out of the rock. Every day he provides water. So he frees them, delivers them, provides water for them, gives them protection. There's a cloud of fire in the night, a cloud in the daytime, so God guides them. And then they have everything they want. And then, again, they complain. Look at what it says in 16:1. It says, the whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. And on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt, in the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. And the Israelites said to them, if we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt, why didn't God just let us die in Egypt? There we sat around with pots of meat and we ate all the food that we wanted, but you have brought us into this desert to starve the entire assembly to death. Ungratitude. They're not grateful. So God said, if you just delivered us then, God, if you'd protect us then, if you gave us water then, now God, you'd give us food. If you gave us food then, we would be grateful. And so look at what God does. So Moses said to them, then the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. When the dew is gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. And when the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? Which is the Hebrew word manna. Manna, or what is it? For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, it is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. It is what the Lord has commanded. Everyone is to go gather as much as they need. Take an omer for each person that you have in your tent, which is plenty to eat. And he said to them, this is what the Lord commanded. Tomorrow is to be a day of Sabbath rest, a holy Sabbath for the Lord. So bake what you want to bake and boil what you want to boil and save whatever is left and keep it to morning. And the Israelites ate manna for 40 years until they came to a land that was settled, and they ate manna until they reached the border of Canaan. So God, if you'll deliver us, we'll be grateful. Wow. Now God, if you'll protect us, well, if you'll give us water, you know, then God, if you'll give us food. So God gives them everything they need. So are they going to be grateful? And so now they have to eat manna. And so like Forrest Gump, they had to come up with every way to make manna. So what are all the ways that you can make manna? You can have baked manna, boiled manna, barbecued manna. You can have manna on a stick, manna burgers, manna salad, manicotti. Manna, banana, cream pie. You know, they had all these ways to make manna. And so what are they saying? God, if you deliver us, then we'll be grateful. God, if you would protect us, then we'll be... God, if you give us water, then we'll be grateful. God, if you give us food, then... And the question that you see building is, what if God gave you everything you asked for? Would you be grateful then? And so look at what it says in Numbers chapter 11, because this is the same story going on, just out of Numbers. It says, now the people complained about their hardships in the hearing of the Lord. The rabble with them began to crave other food. Now we're tired of this manna. And again, the Israelites started wailing and said, if only we had meat to eat. Remember the fish that we ate at Egypt at no cost? Of course, we were slaves, but it was free. And also the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, onions, and garlic. But now we have lost our appetite. We never see anything but this manna. What are they saying? God, if you would just give us meat to eat, then we'll be grateful. Then we'll be grateful. And so God calls Moses to tell him this: consecrate the people. Consecrate yourselves in preparation for tomorrow. And when you will eat meat, the Lord heard you when you wailed. If only we had meat to eat. We were better off in Egypt. Now the Lord will give you meat and you will eat it. And you will not eat it just for one day or for 2 days or 5 days or 10 or 20 days, but for a whole month, until it comes out of your nostrils and you loathe it because you rejected the Lord who is among you, and you have wailed before him saying, why did we ever leave Egypt? You get the sense God's getting a little impatient with his people, right? And then what I love is this next verse that just cracked me up, because Moses makes this powerful statement that he goes into his tent, has a little one-on-one with God, and he says, but Moses said, and now he's speaking just to God, here I am among 600,000 men on foot. Those are just soldiers, so it's well over 2 million people. And you said, I will give them meat to eat for a whole month. Did you think that through, God? Would we have enough if even we took all of our flocks and herds and we slaughtered them? Or would we have enough if all the fish in the sea were caught for them? You didn't think this through, God? There's no delivery system where we can get meat to 2 million people in the middle of the desert. But look at what the Lord said. The Lord said to Moses, is the Lord's arm too short? You don't think I can do this? Now you will see whether or not what I say will come true. How possibly could God deliver meat to 2 million people in the middle of the Sinai Peninsula? Now a wind went out from the Lord, and he drove quail in from the sea, and it scattered them up to 2 cubits deep all around the camp, as far as a day's walk in any direction. And all that day and night, all the next day, the people went out and they gathered quail. No one gathered less than 10 homers, which is a lot, and they spread them all around the camp. But while the meat was still between their teeth, and before it could be consumed, the anger of the Lord burned against the people, and he struck them with a severe plague. Many of them died. Therefore, the place is named Kibroth Hattaavah. I got it, Hattaavah. Because they were buried. There they buried the people who had craved other food. What happens when you just want more and more and more from God? Where does it lead? Do you know what Kibroth Hattaavah means? A grave of craving. It's in the margins of your Bible. Graves of craving. It leads to, you're just going to end up in a grave of craving. Look at what it says in 1 Corinthians 10:6. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things. Psalm 106 tells the same story in a poetic form about how God delivered the people and they complained. And it says, he gave them, in fact, let's read this together. Let's fill God's house with God's word. He gave them exactly what they asked for, but along with it, they got an empty heart. What happens if you get everything that you want? You end up in a grave of craving and an empty heart. That's what would happen if you got everything you ever wanted. And look at what it says in verse 25. They found fault with the life they had, and they turned a deaf ear to God's voice. They no longer heard God's voice. When I was a kid, I watched, a TV show where it started off, and he says, more powerful than a locomotive, faster than a speeding bullet, able to leap tall buildings with a single bound. Look in the sky. It's a bird. No, it's not a bird. It's a plane. No, it's... And Superman had all these supernatural abilities, but he had one weakness, and it was kryptonite. It could kill him. And when you become a follower of Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit, we talked about that in Rooted, that comes into your life that empowers you to live the kind of life that God calls you to live. And there is only one thing that will destroy your spiritual life. You know what the kryptonite to a believer is? An ungrateful heart. When you are not grateful, it will destroy your soul, and it leads to an empty heart. Genesis tells the same thing from the very beginning. Adam and Eve were created in a garden and everything was perfect. It was the land of yes. Can I have yes? Will you provide yes? Everything that we ever wanted. And Satan comes to Eve, remember he says, and he says, did God say that you couldn't eat out of, and Eve says, no, no, we can eat out of any tree. We have every good thing provided for us. There's only one tree at the center of the garden, which is profound because the question at the center of your life, at my life, of everyone's life, is am I going to trust God or am I going to do it my own way? At the center of your life, here's the question. Are you going to believe that God's good and he'll provide? Or do you think there's just one thing that you don't have? And you remember what Satan hissed in Eve's ear? Basically, she said, what Satan said is, you know, God is not good. Because the one thing you don't have is the one thing that you need to be happy. You need to go get it and take care of it yourself. And you know what Satan hisses in your ear every day? The one thing you don't have, that car, that house, that relationship, that spouse, that child, that healing, whatever it was, the one thing you don't have. You know what it shows? That God isn't good. And you need to go and get it yourself. You need to take care of it yourself. And what he's hissing in your ear is a strategy to make you an ungrateful person. Satan's design is to make you ungrateful. And I want to show you why. Because the most important thing that you can do is develop a heart of gratitude. And I think if you start today, and you move through the next 30, 35 days, and every day you just discipline yourself to be grateful, it will change your life. So what does it mean to have a grateful heart? Look at what it says in Psalm 104. The password into God's presence is thank you. All right? You see it in the password. The inner with the password, thank you. Psalm 104. Or you heard it. We enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. So literally what the Bible says is when you say thank you, you are literally putting your soul in the presence of God. You are moving towards heaven. And we know it's true. I mean, parents understand this because what do parents always require kids to say? Say thank you. I remember when I was like in fifth grade, I got what appeared to be a basketball and I was so excited and I was opening it up and this relative gave me a globe and I was, you know, without thinking, I'm going, are you kidding me, a globe? And before I could say, what are you thinking, fifth grader, a globe? My mom grabbed me by the back of the neck and she said, what do you say? Because we know that it just does something good to say so we're going to discipline ourselves. All you have to do is say thank you. So just when you taste something and it tastes really good and you realize God didn't have to make it taste good and he didn't have to give you taste buds, but he did. You can't help but just in your spirit look to heaven and say with a little more alacrity here, okay? Secondly, when you want to do something and your body does it, you're able to react and you realize you have a functioning body, you can't help but say, when you read something or you're talking to somebody and your mind can work and you understand that you can follow this logical conversation, you can't help but say, right, good. When you go to work and you're able to accomplish meaningful things, you say, come on, when you go to work, you say, yeah, there you go. When you see a sunrise or a sunset, you see the beauty of a day and you realize it's just God's gift saying, welcome to this day or I'll watch over you during the night. You can't help but say, and God gives you gift after gift after gift. You can't help but bust out and say, you don't live in Wisconsin, so you say, there you go, all right. Because the leading spiritual indicator, get this, what's the leading spiritual indicator of your life? Thankfulness. Thankfulness. Look at what it says in Romans 1:21. Yes, they knew God, but they would not worship him as God. How do you know? What identifies people who will not worship God? They wouldn't even give him thanks. And what happens when you're not willing to be thankful to God? And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. You drive yourself crazy. And as a result, their minds become dark and confused. Literally, when you aren't grateful, you start to complain. And when you complain, it's a cancer to your soul. And you're moving towards hell and you smell like smoke. So let's just ask the question, how many of you complained in the last week? Okay, wait a second. Let me help you with this, all right? We'll have a mass confession in a second. How many of you have been ungrateful or complained in the last week? And by that I mean you've complained about your money, the markets, the government, or healthcare. You have complained, hold on, you complained about your weight, or you complained about your in-laws, or you complained about your in-laws' weight or money. You complained about traffic, you complained about your weather, you complained about your spouse that you don't have, you complained about the spouse that you do have, you complained about the children you don't have or the children that you do have, you complained about opportunities, you complained about your house, you complained about your car, you complained about your health, you complained about your boss. How many of you in the last week complained? Just raise your hand. Now here's what you need to understand. When you complain, you are moving towards hell and you smell like smoke. That's what it says. But when you are grateful, what does the Bible say? You are moving towards God and you come into the very presence of God by simply saying,
thank you.
That's right. So who's responsible for your thankfulness quotient? Who's responsible? Your spouse? Because all of you are trying to make your spouse responsible, right? Your boss? Your children? How about your church? Is your church responsible for your thankfulness quotient? How about me? Am I responsible for your thankfulness quotient? I am so not. How about God? Is God responsible? Surely, is God responsible? Is God responsible for your thankfulness quotient? Come on, really? Not God? God should be. Isn't God responsible? No, he's not. Who's responsible? Say I am. Who's responsible for your thankfulness quotient? That's right. You and only you. And so our definition, we have our definition as a church of thankfulness is, really? 28 years? I can't teach you anything. What is it? What is our definition? Wanting what I have. Good. Look what it says in 1 Thessalonians 5, 17 and 18. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. What is God's will for you? To give thanks in all circumstances. So, God is a loving Father, and He gives good gifts. And so, for the next 30 days, the world's message is going to, you know, through catalogs and advertisements, marketeers are going to come and just deliver one message. They're going to say, look at your car, look at your furniture, look at your wardrobe, look at your job, look at the things in your life, look at your house. It could be better. It should be better. You deserve better. But thankful people don't think that way because thankful people want what they have. So we're going to go through this thing. I'm going to call out a thing and you're going to go, I want my, and then fill in the blank. It couldn't be better, right? Because thankful people want what they have, all right? So you're going to walk out to your car today. You just fill in the blank. You're going to walk out to your car. The car that God's provided with the dings and the things and all the moans it makes. And it's going to be parked right next to the coolest little new electric car. And you're going to look at your car and say, I want my it. Okay, with a little more alacrity, you need to play here, okay? So then you're going to walk into your house and you're going to open up your closet. You're going to look at your clothes that are a little out of date and doesn't make you look thinner or more attractive. And you're going to say, I love my they. Good, you get the idea. You're going to walk into your tomorrow, your place of work, with all of the people you work with, your boss and the clowns that work along with you, and you're going to say, your job, I love my job. It. You're going to look at your opportunities and challenges as ones that God's given you, and you're going to say, I love my opportunities. They couldn't be better. You're going to look at your body in the mirror, the body that God's given you, and say, I love my
body.
It. Really? You're going to look at your wife, your husband, your family. You're going to say, I love my family. They couldn't be better. Because grateful people want what they have. Because the most grateful people in the world are coffee drinkers. That's right. And they model gratitude every day of their life. They wake up and they stumble into the kitchen or to the local coffee shop and they get that first cup of coffee and they hold it close because it is like their own private little fireplace. And they just stand there for a moment, breathing in the aroma of coffee, which is one of God's greatest single gifts in the world. And they just anticipate the taste of it. And then they hold it up. They take the very first sip of coffee and they, because that's what thankful people say. They say, so just let's practice that. So you're going to go to your car, even though it's next to that cool electric car, and you're going to look at your car and say, you're going to go to your home or apartment, the one that God's given you to take care of you, and you're going to go, you're going to open up your closet and look at your clothes that don't make you look thin and don't make you look cool, and you're going to go, you're going to go to work tomorrow and look at the people that you work with that are God's gift to you, your boss, the people that you work with, and go, you're going to look at your spouse as they get up in the morning, even though they're sort of drooling and there's a mattress damage, and you're going to say, you're going to wake up and look at your body in the mirror and go, because grateful people want what they have. And contented people, what's our definition of contented? Contentment? Not wanting more, right? Because we ask every year, who is more content? The man with $5 million or the man with five children? And the obvious answer is the man with five kids, because he doesn't want any more. Philippians 4:1 says, I have learned to be content with whatever I have. Any of you born content? Not one of you. It is a learned discipline. And a learned discipline where it says, I want what I have and I don't need anything more. Contented is constantly looking at the world and going, I don't need it. I don't need anything more. Because it is tricky business, and it's something that we have to learn, because most of us, we're here, and we say, you know what, I'm pretty sure I'd be content there. You know, wherever you are, you know, if I had that house, if I had that car, if I had that income, I can't be content here, but there. But I'll tell you, there's people that are there in this room. And you know what they tell you about there? They'd say, I'm here, and I'm telling you, it's not here, it's there, because it's not, you know, I just need a little bit more income, a little bigger house, a little nicer car, because you can't be content here, but I'm pretty sure it's, but you know what, I know there's people in this room that are there, and what they tell you about there is that it's not here, it's there, and so, and they, you know, it's just that house, the nicer house, that car, two cars, three houses, five houses, you know, they go, it's not, and here's what you need to learn. If you can't be content, here, you will never be content, there, because contentment is only found right here. Exactly. And so he says in this passage, what he's saying is, I've learned to be content. And over the next 35 days, marketeers and advertisers have spent hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars to deliver catalogs and advertisements, to show you gadgets and things and stuff, to make you say one thing, I need that. They are not going to sell, be content with what you have. You don't need this. They're not spending that kind of money to deliver the message, you don't need this. Be grateful for what you have. They're going to spend huge amounts of money. So we are not born content, so we have to become content. So you are going to look at catalogs, you are going to look at TV advertisements, and you're going to have to say out loud, I don't need it, all right? So we're going to just go through that discipline right now, okay? So you're going to open up a catalog to Himmler and Slammer or those, one of those other places, and you're going to see some new gadget you didn't even know existed. And with some passion and energy, you're going to say, you're going to open up those catalogs that are going to show you clothes that are beautiful, that would make you look slim and 20 years younger. And you're going to say, good. You're going to open up those things or see advertisement. You're going to see new furniture that would make your house look so much cooler. And you're going to go, come on, with some passion and some commitment here. You're going to go out golfing with your friend, and he's going to have the new hyperdrive with the overhead differentiated windshield wipers, and you're going to hit that thing, and you're going to hit it straighter and farther than you ever hit it, and you're going to hand him back that club and say, I need that, right? See, you're just going, no, I need that, right? I don't need it. If I took Lori to Fashion Island and I gave her one day of shopping, all expenses, everything she wants, buys anything that she wants for a whole day, would she be content? We will never know. The lottery is going to get north of, you know, hundreds, $300 million, $400 million. And it always does in the month of December. We know why. Because of the magical thinking that we all have. Oh, you know, I've kind of burned through a lot of money, got myself in debt. That's how God wants to provide for me. I'm sure that God wants to give me $400 million. And so you're going to walk through the lottery, you know, the line, and they're going to go, do you want to buy a lottery ticket? And you're going to say, with some passion and courage, because if you needed $400 million, your heavenly Father would give it to you, because he's a loving Father and he would provide everything that you need. But he knows that if you had that kind of money, it would smell and come out of your nostrils and you'd have an empty heart. And we wouldn't like you, and neither would your family. And you would live a small, tiny, selfish little life, and you would give no more money than you give right now. And God knows it, because you don't need it. You don't need it. And so look at what it says in Psalm 118. This is the day, the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is how God wants us to live. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is. That's the most often repeated phrase in the whole Bible. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is. And we say all the time. God is good all the time. And so when it says give thanks to the Lord, look at what it says. You know, does that mean in every, you know, situation, really, are we kind of crazy people? And so in all circumstances, we give thanks. And the idea is, you know, so I'm going to be grateful. And some of you, you've had a hell of a year. You have cancer. Found out this year you lost a loved one. You lost a job. Are you supposed to be grateful for cancer? No. Are you supposed to be grateful for the loss of a loved one? Never. You're supposed to be grateful for pain and sadness? No. Well, then how is it that we give thanks in those circumstances? Because we believe God is good. And when you believe that God is good, you are embracing what it says in Romans 8:28, where that God is able in every situation to work for the good. We live in a broken world. Cancer is not good. It's part of a broken world. And there's disease. That's not what God wants. But God is able to work for our good in that. God is able to work good in the pain, in the loss, when you don't have a job. That God is working. Romans 5 says that he builds character, and so we hold on. So how do we live in this life? Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation. This is in every. By prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. What are we supposed to do? God, I'm overwhelmed. I don't know what to do. Don't be anxious. You talk to God. You be grateful that he is good, that he's working in your life, and you tell him what you need. You tell him what you need. And when you do that, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding. Will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That's what it means. We are not simple people that are grateful for bad things. We understand this is a difficult, complicated world. But look at what David said in Psalm 103. Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things that he has done for me. When we say thank you, we literally usher our heart into the presence of God. It changes who we are. We want what we have. It breaks the discontent of wanting more. On the bottom of your outlines right now, what I'd like you to do is start to write out 10 things for which you're grateful. If you don't have a pen, just start thinking about what you'd put on each line. Come up with 10 things. Wednesday night, we're going to gather at 6:30. And you know why we gather? Because it's critical that we take another shot and another run. You're going to hear stories. We're going to worship. We're going to sing gratitude in our hearts. So our goal is that you can gather with your family, wherever that is, or whoever you're going to gather with on Thanksgiving Day. And you can say, what are you grateful for? Let me tell you what I'm grateful for. And you can rifle through your list. So just write out right now what you're grateful for. I'll tell you my list for today. Yesterday, I went for a walk with Lori. We were walking for like about 45 minutes, and all we did was we said, what are we grateful for? We talked for 45 minutes. It was a thrill. Of course, at the top of Lori's list, what she's grateful for is, I'm grateful for her. But grateful for our health. We're grateful for our family, our new family. My sons, I have 4 sons. 3 of them got married in the last 12 months. And my sons, they are geniuses at choosing the right women. It's amazing. And they have chosen just wonderful life partners for themselves, all of them walking with the Lord. I'm grateful for my home. I'm grateful for my friends. I'm grateful for protection. Now you write down what you're grateful for. I'm just telling you what I'm grateful for. Grateful for our church. Last week, and just in this last week in our church, over 125 people stood and said, I believe. Lots of people got baptized and rooted. Just amazing to see God's work. The love that you've shown, your generosity is amazing to me. Last week, you just flooded the patio, and you took tags, and you took grocery bags and filled them up, and your generosity, it changes things. And I love how you are generous. I love how you are committed to meeting your neighbors, getting to know their names so that you can begin to pray for them and pray for their good in your neighborhoods. I love the stories that I've heard about that. I love the opportunity that I have at our church to invest in the next generation of leaders, the young leaders that we have in our church and all the church campuses. It is awesome. The church is going to be in such good hands as these people emerge to take their place. It's incredible. What are the things that you're grateful for? Write them down. Because I'll tell you this. Satan is going to show up every day in your life, and he's going to hiss in your ear through advertisements and marketeers this message. This one thing you don't have right here, this is the one thing that you need, and God hasn't given it to you. You need to go get that. Because God isn't good. He's not good. You can't be contented with what you have. This one thing. It's what you need. And he isn't giving it to you. And you need to understand it is the lie from hell itself. As he hisses at you, God's not good. You don't have this one thing. And the only way you're going to break that is when you're able to say, I love what I have. I don't need that. I don't need that. It's the only thing. So look at your list right now. Just look down at it. Think about what's on your list. Let's pray. Father, when we look at the many things that you've given to us, we are overwhelmed with gratitude. You didn't have to. We didn't deserve it. But you're a loving father who loves to give good gifts to your children. Some of your gifts are amazing because even in the pain and the sadness, you brought comfort. You've built us up with friends. You've walked through some of the most darkest days. You never left us. And you're working for our good. We see your provision. We see your protection. And so, God, right now, as we spend even the next moment worshiping and singing, would you cause our spirits to soar? Would you fill us with an overwhelming sense that you are good and that you give good gifts to your children?